Arturo Toscanini in 1946, conducting part of the great Te Deum, which concludes the Quattro Pezzi Sacri, Four Sacred Pieces, published in 1898. Toscanini visited Verdi again in January 1901. The year had begun well enough, as Verdi reported to his sister-in-law, Barbarina Strepponi.
New Year's Day, 1901. I am quite well, as ever, but I am absolutely attached to my chair. It's hardly moving. Let's hope that beautiful days like this one will go on. And then we will also be free of the cold. I am writing only a little now, because writing tires me. But you, with your firm hand, you write to me. I know Maria gives you my news. She is fine and sends her regards. With my whole heart, I grasp your hands.
When Toscanini called on him some 3 weeks later, he was very cordially received, as before, but he was distressed to find Verdi in a state of some confusion. On the following morning, the old man began to tremble, his fingers struggling in vain with the buttons of his waistcoat as he tried to get dressed. "One button more, one button less," he muttered, and he never said another word. Felled by a stroke that would have killed many a younger man, he hung on, unconscious, for a week, and at 3 o'clock in the morning, on the 27th of January, he died. Boito had been by his bedside for much of that week, and recalled,
"He died magnificently, like a fighter, formidable and mute. The silence of death had fallen over him a week before he died. With head bowed on his breast and knitted brows, he looked downwards and seemed to weigh with his glance an unknown and formidable adversary and to calculate mentally the forces needed to oppose him. His resistance was heroic. The breathing of his great chest sustained him for 4 days and 3 nights. On the fourth night, the sound of his breathing still filled the room. But what a struggle. Poor maestro. How brave and handsome he was, up to the last moment. In the course of my life, I have lost those I have idolized, and grief has outlasted resignation. But never have I experienced such a feeling of hatred against death, of such loathing for that mysterious, blind, stupid, triumphant, and craven power. It needed the death of this octogenarian to arouse those feelings in me. He too hated it, for he was the most powerful expression of life that it is possible to imagine. He hated it as he hated laziness, enigmas, and doubt. But now, all is over. He sleeps like a king of Spain in his Escurial, under a bronze slab that completely covers him.
It was only hours after Verdi's death that the Italian Senate was called into special session on Sunday, the 27th of January. No one was absent. Eulogy followed eulogy, and the president of the Council of Ministers eloquently lamented the extinguishing of that shining star who illuminated the entire civilized world with his glory.
"This great man and artist deserved more than anyone to be the symbol of the heroic era of our Risorgimento, because of the mystic fusion of his music and the longed-for, prayed-for unity of the nation around the throne of its first king. Verdi was our great unifier, when the wave of his passionate music, something that the enemy could not seize, embodied the idea of the nation, which swept freely from the Alps to the sea, setting our hearts on fire.
On the day of the funeral, men and women of the highest rank from many countries converged on Milan to pay their last respects to a man regarded by many as the greatest musician of his time. No head of state, no monarch in the 19th century attracted a greater number or eminence of dignitaries to his funeral than Verdi. Tens of thousands of people lined the streets, and at one point, as if by some unseen celestial signal, they began spontaneously to sing the chorus of the Hebrew slaves from Nabucco, which had become a kind of unofficial anthem for a unified Italy. In the words of a contemporary report,
"The white road along the outside of the city walls, broad and lined with huge horse chestnut trees, was boiling with a restless throng that was obviously struck with emotion. At Porta Garibaldi, the crowd packed the whole area. A wave of silence moved ahead of the procession. Then the ranks of the Savoia cavalry filled the entire street. At the sides, soldiers and national policemen formed a great, empty, open square space. In the middle was the priest, two candles at the sides. Then the hearse, with a narrow black coffin on it. Then another rank of troops closed the open area at the rear and kept back the crowd that was pressing from behind. The people moved together in a strange, disorderly way, like ocean waves. At the cemetery, where the whole square before the gate was sealed off, the crowd stood motionless, silent. Formality, the ancient classical Italian evil, was conquered that day by the grand will of the old man, wise and provident maestro, even after death. No apotheosis for the dead was ever more magnificent than that silence, which he commanded from his simple bier."
But the breaking of that silence, when it came, heralded a century and more in which Verdi's music would resound the world over at the very center of the operatic repertoire, taking its rightful place next to the epoch-making masterworks of Mozart and Wagner. A true peasant he may never have been, but his music continues to reach the hearts of a wider range of people, from the humblest to the most illustrious, than that perhaps of any other so-called classical composer, and there's no reason to believe that it will ever cease to do so.